Chapter 1, An Introduction to Genetics. Every chapter in your textbook has what I call vignettes. This one is called Albinism Among the Hopis. You are responsible to read these on your own and to know what the gene is that is being described, what kind of unusual, typically unusual phenotype is associated with that gene, mutations in that gene, and sort of what the special story or circumstances are that are being described. So you want to be able to summarize it in maybe 3 or 4 sentences as you're studying for the exam. So we really begin chapter 1 with this concept that an understanding of genetics is really important in society, and it's becoming more important all the time. Nowadays, people are having their DNA tested, but they don't really know what the information they get back from that means. And so you potentially will be helping people interpret some of that information that they get back. If you work in a medical field, you will be looking at results from genetic testing and translating that back to the patient, telling them what it means and what it doesn't mean. And so this is becoming very important in general, and there really aren't a lot of people who really, really understand the genetics and the information. So my goal is to help you be more adept at doing that in your future career or just in your life as a citizen. One thing I'd like to make clear is that at this point, we are heavily dependent on GMO food products and recombinant DNA for pharmaceuticals. So these are already a huge part of our food supply and a huge part of our medical pharmaceuticals that are used, very important ones like human insulin and clotting factor, for example. There's a lot of these recombinant DNA pharmaceuticals and recombinant DNA crops that are already a big part of our life. So you're already involved with these kinds of genetic products. As we study different organisms, what becomes apparent to us is that a lot of organisms have the same genes or very similar types of genes. And what's different between them is how the genes are regulated, meaning that one gene is expressed potentially in a particular tissue at a particular time, in a particular amount, and maybe in a different organism it's expressed differently. So it's not the actual genes themselves that are usually the main difference. It's how much of the gene is expressed at what time in development in what tissue. So in this picture, you have a stained embryo fruit fly, and they've stained the embryo for a gene, a type of HOX gene. A HOX is a gene that is actually a group of genes that set up the body pattern in the early embryo. We have HOX genes. Flies have HOX genes. Lots of animals, segmented animals, have HOX genes. And what's different between the fly's HOX genes and the human HOX genes is mainly how often they're expressed, meaning how many segments there will be, and at what time in development, and how to what length or to what level they're expressed. There are 3 basic divisions or fields of genetics. One is called transmission genetics, shown here with the family of cats representing that. So families, how genes, how alleles and phenotypes are passed from parent to child. Yeah, that's transmission genetics. We usually call it vertical transmission. Then there's molecular genetics, which focuses on the biochemistry of the molecules. How do the genes produce the proteins? How do the proteins interact in the cell? And then the third field is population genetics. So it's more at the evolutionary level, more at looking at how a population changes over time genetically. And so we will look at both of all 3 of these, but mainly transmission genetics and molecular genetics. These are the 6 commonly used model organisms in genetics research. Model organisms are studied heavily because they're, for whatever reason, easy to work with, and they have genetics that relates to in some way to either human or we can learn something about ourselves from their genetics. For this material, you need to know the name of the organism, both the common name and the scientific name. So I'm going to pronounce each of these for you. The first one is Drosophila melanogaster, and that's the fruit fly. The second one is Escherichia coli, which is a bacterium that lives in your colon. The third one is Caenorhabditis elegans, and that's a nematode worm. The fourth one is Arabidopsis thaliana. It's the thalecress plant. Then Mus musculus is the house mouse. And Saccharomyces cerevisiae is baker's yeast. There are more model organisms than this, but these are among the top six. Certainly, if you ask people to name the top 10, these six would be in that group. So these will be the six model organisms that are featured in future chapters. For now, you need to know their scientific name and their common name. So why do we study model organisms? Mainly because it leads to technology and advances that can be used for humans. Typically, we're trying to solve a human problem. And you have basic research, which is research into all of these organisms just for the sake of knowledge. But among that basic research, what emerges are things that can become useful to us. So some basic research, when you're doing the research, you don't know what the usefulness might be. And later, it actually, you realize that it is useful knowledge. So we study, for example, zebrafish in this example. There's a mutation in zebrafish that parallels the mutation or the variation that we see in human skin color. And so zebrafish genes and human genes are similar or the same. And so by studying maybe not skin color, but other genes in zebrafish, we can learn things about human. So zebrafish is actually not one of the six that they named, but if I had to pick a top 10, zebrafish would be in that group. So studying model organisms, we use it to develop things that we can use to help ourselves or hopefully help the planet in general. Now, genetic manipulation is not a new thing. Selective breeding, animal domestication, certain agricultural techniques, those have been used for thousands of years, ever since humans figured out how to farm. And to some extent, these are maybe common sense. You would choose your strongest cow and your strongest bull if you wanted to have, you know, a successful, a strong calf. But what you're doing there is you're manipulating the sexual reproduction to get a desired outcome. Same thing is done with plants. But what is different is now we can do things faster, you know, and with technology in a different way. But the manipulation itself is not new. Now we switch to, I guess since we've been talking about 10,000 years ago when humans started manipulating genetics, we go into more of a historical part of this chapter. In the, let's say, mid, you know, 1600s, 1700s, there were different ideas about how heredity worked, how information is passed from parent to child. And one wrong concept that was believed to be correct is called pangenesis. And at that time, they thought that there was some kind of fluid or some kind of, they called them humors, that at the moment of conception or at the moment of mating, that would be kind of drawn out of all the parts of the body. And then they would go to the reproductive organs. It would go and be put into the embryo. They didn't have a concept of the embryo, but that's what it would be. So, you know, some kind of liquid information, something was sucked out of all parts of the body at that moment, and all of that just mixed into the embryo, like paint mixing together. And so the offspring would be a mixture of traits from the mother and the father. And there's something about that that's not completely wrong, but of course we know that it's more particulate than that. It's actually just the chromosomes, which all your cells have, but the chromosomes in the eggs and the sperm are what's passed to the embryo, to the zygote. And so it's just the genes, not there's not a liquidy portion that's passed from all parts of the body. So that is the correct theory. It's called germplasm theory. There was also a wrong concept in those early times, 1700s, called preformationism, or that's what it became to be known as. It was the idea that inside a sperm there would be a tiny little man. You can see in this picture a tiny little man inside this sperm. He has a giant head, I guess. That when the sperm was delivered to the uterus, the uterus acted as an incubator, and this would just get larger and larger and grow. That's called preformationism. And of course, that's wrong as well. So there were a lot of wrong ideas about inheritance. And until we finally get to Mendel. And so I have a very brief history of things that came before Mendel. So not only these concepts of preformationism and pangenesis, and some of those ideas really track all the way back to Aristotle. But in 1665, you start to be able to see cells with the microscope. So that was the beginning of a new understanding of the cellular nature of reproduction. In 1839, you may recall, Schlott and Schwann separately proposed cell theory. And cell theory is, you'll recall, the idea that all cells come from other cells by cell division, that the cell is the smallest unit of life, and all organisms are made up of one or more cells. So those are the three tenets of cell theory that you should rewind and write down. And then in 1859, Darwin published On the Origin of Species, which was around the same time that Mendel published Experiments in Plant Hybrids. And they didn't see the connection really between their work. In fact, it's not even clear that they were aware of each other at that time as being contemporaries, as working at the same time. But it turns out that if Darwin had known about Mendel's work, it may have improved his explanation of inheritance in his book, because Darwin's explanation of inheritance in that book is terrible. It's wrong. So Mendel came out with this publication, Experiments in Plant Hybrids. Of course, nobody, we'll talk a lot about Mendel, nobody appreciated it at the time, but now in hindsight, we consider him the father of genetics. So Mendel died in 1884, and it wasn't until 1900 that three scientists named de Vries, Correns, and Shermack, and there was one other guy, I can't remember his name right now, who rediscovered Mendel's work. And by rediscovered, we mean they did, individually, they did similar kinds of experiments, came to the same conclusions, but then they found this old publication in which Mendel had already explained or described this concept of inheritance. And in science, only the first person gets credit for a new idea or for a new discovery. So they never became famous. And then in 1902, again, individually, Sutton and Boveri, working not together but individually, were able to explain what eventually became known as the chromosomal theory of inheritance. They didn't call it that right at first, but it's the idea that genes are carried on chromosomes, chromosomes are passed from cell to cell during cell division, and therefore the chromosome is the basis of inheritance. There's a lot of things, though, that happened in the 1900s, and we will spend time going through some of that history, and I do want you to know the history. But fast forward into the 2000s, we have the Human Genome Project and the various genome projects that happened where the DNA of entire humans was sequenced to determine the A, C, and G, and T sequence of nucleotides on the chromosomes. This picture shows what the computer output looks like for a DNA sequencing run, and I can explain to you what exactly it means later on. I worked on the Human Genome Project for couple years, and so in 2001 was the initial publication of the genome, and in 2003 it was considered completed. And so we went from, you know, about 1900 to barely recognizing what Mendel had discovered, moving into 2000, being able to manipulate genomes and determine the sequence of the genome. So a lot happened in the 20th century. So I'm going to wrap up this slideshow or this presentation with a summary of some things that I would expect you to already know from other courses. The first thing is the basic structure and function of prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. And if you come across something that you sort of recognize but you can't recall, then you need to go look it up again. So just a warning, you know, just be ready to remind yourself about some of those things that you may have forgotten. Cell theory, I mentioned that earlier in this presentation. There are three parts to cell theory. And then we're going to delve into quite a bit what the relationship is between genotype and phenotype. You think you know what the relationship is, but I'm going to change that understanding for you quite a bit. At least I hope I do. Because that relationship is not as close as you might think. But a basic understanding of what genotype and phenotype are. The fundamental process of gene expression, so I'm talking about transcription and translation and how those work in a basic way. Cell division, so mitosis and meiosis. And then a basic understanding of evolution. So even if those aren't super fresh, those should look familiar. Those should be things that you can go back and refresh if necessary. And so those would be my assumptions coming into this course, since you do have a prerequisite. So that's going to wrap up my first lecture to you. And remember, if you have any questions, just let me know.